the map. Times like now, you feel the wrath. Take control, you do the math. Stay on point, this is the path. This is real, no substitute. Get it right, don't be confused. It's alright, you have the tools.
Hello and welcome to The Sound Test Live, your weekly celebration of video game music in all of its forms. Only this week shifted onto a Saturday, onto a different day, thanks to last night's near-death experience. Now that definitely sounds interesting, so we'll give a little bit of background on that. But firstly, what we heard there kicking off the show was Electric Night from an artist called Model 500, which was included on the fourth official soundtrack disc from Detroit's Become Human. Lewis has already asked in the chat exactly where in the game it was used, and that's a very good question. I'm actually not entirely sure myself. We all know licensed tracks in a big game like Detroit Become Human can hide sometimes. All sorts of tracks on Grand Theft Auto 5, for example, that I don't think I've ever heard, but they're in there and they're licensed and who knows where the hell they're hidden. But yeah, I'm not exactly sure where that's used in Detroit Become Human, but it's included on the official OST, so we'll go ahead with that being actually licensed video game music for this week. And that of course does tie into yesterday's premiere of the Detroit Become Human ST2 episode with Nima Fakara and Philip Shepherd, and what an extravaganza it is. I know a few of you regular guys were there to hear it, and it's basically 2 hour entirety. So thank you very much to everyone who was there for the premiere and listened to the whole thing and left comments in the chat for me to check back on after I came back to life after a very difficult experience. I really appreciate those comments, so thank you for checking it out. And if you haven't heard it yet, it's a podcast I would recommend to anybody. Trust me, you do not have to have played Detroit Become Human. You do not even have to really know anything about Detroit Become Human to get something out of it. It's one of my favorite podcasts that I've ever come out with, and go check it out. It should be available on all the platforms that you're listening to this on, and it should be the thing just before this episode. However, I wasn't able to share it with you guys, and I had to duck out and I had to cancel the live show and move on to today. And you guys know me, and you know how on the clock I like to be with this stuff, and how I really hate to cancel it or move it around. So it had to have been a big thing. It had to have been an actual reason. And honestly, I just couldn't take it anymore last night. We got about halfway into the Detroit Become Human premiere, and my body just noped out. My body just said, no more, you have to go to bed. And my head was absolutely buzzing with like pure pain on the whole right side. My hands actually started shaking, and I stood up to go and get a drink to try and make myself better, and I fell directly over because my center of balance had shifted right down to my feet. It was ridiculous. So I went to have a shower while the premiere was still on, thinking maybe I can shake this out of me. Maybe I can just disappear for 20 minutes, come back because it's a 2-hour podcast, and feel better and get on with the live show. But no, as soon as I got out of the shower, I nearly fell over again from the lack of balance. I just thought, you know what? There's no point in attempting to drill our way through a live show feeling like this, because it'll just be a disaster and it'll just let everybody down. So we'll shift on to the Saturday instead, get a good fat sleep, get a good fat meal, actually beef up the playlist a little bit, because at first this playlist was only an hour long to come after the Detroit Become Human podcast. Now I've beefed it up, and it should just about make 2 hours, just about. Got some extra requests in there in the last minute. So all in all, I think it's a good thing that we've moved on to Saturday, and we've got pretty much all of the regular guys in. Jerry, Thor, Lewis, Shady, Ollie, missing Felix, missing Jessica, but we have moved on to a different day, so that's kind of understandable. We've got so much on the show to get through today. This week we are doing games to films, my top five. If you're a regular listener of the show, you'll know that last week we took a look at my top five game to film adaptations. No, it was the other way around, film to game adaptation. So maybe I should have had an actual longer sleep. But yeah, last week we were looking at films to games. This week we're looking at games to films. It's kind of understandable that that's a little bit confusing, isn't it? But yeah, we've got five games to films representing my choices this week. And we've also got a few of yours along the way. We've got some requests that have absolutely nothing to do with films. We've got some choices from me that have absolutely nothing to do with films. And we've got a new question at the end of the show to lead into next week. Sound Effects Showdown, VGM SongFight Battle, full platter of things to get through. And we're over yesterday's horribleness, and I think you guys just enjoyed the Detroit Become Human podcast, so that's fortunate, and we can just move on with a fresh slate of VGM goodness. First up, we're going to move straight into a request. Wireless play menu from Mario Kart 8 Deluxe, and this is an absolute tune. Thank you for sending this one through, Ollie. I've never heard this one, which is strange, because I'm a big, big Mario Kart 8 fan, and in particular Deluxe I played a lot when I first got my Switch. I wasn't the biggest fan of it, but I played it a lot. So wireless play menu, did I ever do wireless play? I don't think I really actually did much multiplayer on Mario Kart 8 Deluxe, so that's why it might have hidden under the radar for me. But thank you for showing it to me, because this is pure VGM. This is exactly the kind of thing I'm in VGM for, and I think it kicks off the show perfectly. Wireless play menu from Mario Kart 8 Deluxe. The end titles from Curse of Monkey Island, composed by Michael Land, who has worked on the Monkey Island series from the very beginning, along with Peter McConnell and Clint Bajakian. But Curse of Monkey Island, which was the third in the series, if I'm not wrong, was handled entirely by Michael Land, and there's some really, really cool stuff on there. Me and Thor have been talking about this stuff in emails this week, and he's been wondering if there was ever an official release of the Monkey Island music, and I'm not sure, I'm not entirely sure that there was. Most of the time when I look for Monkey Island music, it's pretty bootleggy, which is what Thor was talking about with me, and there's a bootleggy element to what we just heard there, and I actually kind of like that though. It takes me back to that sound of like early PC audio when those kind of sampled sounds and that kind of higher quality sampled sounds were just coming in. So they still had like this compression, this kind of sound where they'd been pushed down in file size to fit on the CD and or the disc or whatever it may be. And they have this kind of sound, this very specific sound, and I'm very glad that that kind of retained that. And it kind of links into something that we're going to end the show with today, much later on, but we'll talk about it briefly now because I've tied that track into it deliberately. And it's this really cool demo tape, actually, that Thor has tracked down. I'm going to end the show with it because it's not music, but it's actually a demo tape from Dominic Armato, who plays Guybrush Threepwood, the main character of Monkey Island, is his voice actor. And it's believed to be a demo reel, essentially, of his acting abilities and what might have helped land him the job of Guybrush Threepwood. It's usually included in a lot of Curse of Monkey Island bootleg soundtracks. You can find it on a few. I've looked it up, Thor, you're right, because that's how Thor found this, is in an unofficial bootleg soundtrack for Curse of Monkey Island. A really, really interesting demo reel of the voice actor Dominic Armato. So we'll hear that right at the end of the show, because as I say, it's about 3 minutes of just like clips and snippets and little comedy bits. So we'll leave that till right at the end. But it's really, really interesting little relic that Thor has brought to the show. And thought we would tie the end titles from Curse of Monkey Island into that. So awesome, nice little kickoff to the show, tie into Detroit Become Human, then wireless play menu, incredible request from Ollie. We have found out that that plays when you're attempting to connect two consoles together, and that's why I had no idea what that was and had never heard it before. And then into Curse of Monkey Island, which is a really, really lovely Michael Land tune. We don't play nearly enough Michael Land on this show. So before we hear last week's sound effects, I'll mention quickly, it looks like Richard Branson is having an issue with this show again. He is this show's arch nemesis, our main villain, our main antagonist. And keeping my eye on my little internet traffic light, it's mostly green, but every now and then it's deciding to flicker. And I feel like Branson, who, by the way, is my internet service provider, in case you're new to the show and wondering, has decided to give me a little bit of agita tonight, flicking around with my internet. So hopefully we'll be able to make it nice and strong throughout most of tonight's stream. If not, we're always recording it. God damn you, Branson. Isn't this 2 weeks in a row? Maybe it's something to do with lockdown. I know the internet is definitely strained during lockdown, and maybe I can use that as an excuse. So moving into last week's sounds from the Sound Effects Showdown before we hear this week's sounds, which I have cooked up for you, the last round. So the Sound Effects Showdown is where we hear three sounds from three different games, and you guess what the sounds are and what the games are that they're from, for 6 points in total. After 5 weeks, I count up everybody's points, and whoever's got the most is going to win some kind of prize, although Shady keeps running away with it, and I can't keep buying my brother fried chicken. because that kind of goes against the whole point of the goddamn sound effects showdown. So yeah, I might have to start banning Shady from the sound effects showdown, or do what we suggested a couple of weeks ago, which was have Shady make the sounds instead, and I'll play along too, because we discussed that and I think he said he was up for that. So yeah, we might do that after this round. So yeah, sound effects showdown, this is last week's three sounds from three different games. Your last chance to get your answers in. I'll be going around social media, Twitter, where I'm at GreenTea128, Facebook, where I'm The Sound Test, and I'll be checking my emails too to get any answers in that I've missed. This is your last chance, and then we'll hear this week's round five. So this is round four. Twice more. Yeah, Branson's keeping the internet nice and green throughout this. I can tell he's sat with his notepad wanting to make sure he doesn't miss a single one of these sounds. As much as he hates this show, he still wants to win. So we'll let those percolate in your mind, and you've got these next tracks to get your answers in. And actually, boy bloody howdy, you haven't got much time. These tracks only last for, both of them together, 2 minutes and 26 seconds. So this is going to be rough. This is going to be rough chuckles. I might have to actually gather some of the answers during the next link. We'll see. This is going to be a race. But this is my first game to film adaptation. Number five in my top five game to film. I'm going to make that mistake all throughout the show. I know I am. So let me try and solidify this. It's game to film this week. So that's what was games first in adapted into movies. So I have to include this. I'm sorry, people might be shaking their head and thinking this should be nowhere near a top five video game movies list. Nowhere near it. But I have to include it because this is my personal list. Street Fighter. I love it. It's probably my biggest guilty pleasure. I unequivocally love that movie. I don't even really make excuses for it. Like, yeah, it's really bad and that's why I love it, is to laugh at it. No, I really love that movie. And I don't know if it's because I had it on VHS as quite a young kid when my VHS collection was really small, which therefore meant it got a lot of play. I used to watch it over and over and over and over again as a kid. And of course, I know it's stupid. I know it's kind of silly. And as I've grown older, I've been able to see all of the stupid things in it. But still, it's not like become something where I'm just laughing at it. I still really like it for what it is. Of course, it gets a lot wrong, but it's quite surprising how much it gets right. When you look at video game movies, I mean, for God's sake, we all know how good Bison is in that movie, providing us with such fantastic lines as, "But for me, it was a Tuesday," which is an absolute classic. That Bison performance is iconic. And you can't really fault the Guile, really. He is what he is. The whole movie is a silly action flick, but I feel does kind of capture the spirit of Street Fighter, or at least the spirit of many of those characters. Not all of them, certainly. Some of them were absolutely bastardized. In particular, comes to mind something like Dalsim, for example, was used really badly in that film. Just becomes a kind of like a genetic scientist who contributes towards Blanka. But yeah, on the whole, I have a lot of fun with that movie and find it highly quotable. It's a lot of fun between me and my brother. We've always quoted this for years. So let's hear two interesting VGM relics to, we learned about commemorate last week, didn't we? So we're okay to use the word commemorate to commemorate the Street Fighter movies. Now, it turns out the Street Fighter movie had two video games based directly off the film, which is kind of weird because now we're doing music from a game that's based on a film that's based on a game. But it still represents a game film. You know what I mean. This is all getting very, very convoluted and confusing. But we know what I mean. And there were two different games for the Street Fighter movie. One on the PlayStation 1 and the Saturn. And another one was a standalone arcade game. And they were both fighting games that used like digital You might have seen this kind of thing, like kind of photos of real people digitized into like sprites. It's that kind of thing. So you're like actually playing as the actors in this case. It's really weird. But I think both of these movies were both of these games were as critically panned as the movie that they're based on. But there was some interesting music in there. From the arcade version, we're going to hear a version of Ryu's theme, which is, of course, a VGM classic, but it's interesting to hear it on the sounds that they've used on this arcade cabinet. But before that, we've got a 26-second snippet from the PlayStation version of the Street Fighter movie game. And that's because the music to that game was pretty much entirely awful. Like, really wasn't very good at all. But I did want to play something from it in this little duo sandwich of Street Fighter movie music. And I picked this out because it was 26 seconds long and I actually thought it had some pretty fun raging bass on it. So let's get into this. I've got no idea what its title is. None of the websites where I was downloading stuff from could tell me what this was. So who knows from the PlayStation version of Street Fighter the movie. So, yes, an alternate version of Ryu's theme from the arcade Street Fighter movie game. So I just thought it'd be interesting to hear that. We all know Ryu's theme, and no offense, but we all know the original and some of its various remixes obviously blow that out of the water. But since we were talking about the Street Fighter movie, I wanted to listen to some of the music. And actually, there's some really interesting remixes on that, actually. And if you're really into your Street Fighter music, your Street Fighter 2 music, you want to go and check out the arcade Street Fighter movie game music, because there's some really interesting renditions of the original themes with different sounds. Some of them good, some of them not so good. But yeah, well worth checking out. All sorts of stuff going on in the chat. And I think I've just about got everybody's answers in. Although, let's say I've been a bit all over the place with my points recently. And I still need to go back and double check whether I need to add extra points for the whole Half-Life Source Games portal button noise confusion from last week. So I haven't done that yet. And I'll make sure that next week, the points that I give for the final round will be 100% definitive. Definitely. But I can just say now that people were stumped a little bit with last week's sound effects, because we only got, I believe, 1.4 Ollie and 1.4 Lewis. And even Shady came through with a complete and utter blank slate on the sounds from last week. So that is a surprise. Let's hear them one more time and give these answers out on what they actually are. So that is basically a ration, or I think there's a few items that make that noise, but we'll say a ration from Metal Gear Solid. And I would have taken really any Metal Gear Solid game, because that follows through the entire series from the very first one right up until 5, I believe. That is a pause from Super Mario 64, and I think that is where Lewis got his point, and I also think that's where Ollie got his point. I might be wrong about that, but yeah, classic sound, that pausing on Super Mario 64, which I would hope you have done many a time if you're a classic gamer. And that is a banana coin. I believe there might be other collectibles that make that noise, from specifically Donkey Kong Country 2, Diddy's Conquest. But I think, again, that might have followed through to other Donkey Kong games. However, nobody actually got that one, so it doesn't matter, and I don't have to worry about whether I've got the sound right or not. Interesting, I thought they were all pretty big sounds, and as Ollie has said, are nads. Indeed, it's weird how that ration sailed under the radar. I don't actually think that's one I would have got myself if Shady made the sounds, for example. This is why I want Shady to do it, because I think it'll show me how hard it is to get these in isolation when you have no idea what they are. Because of course, when I go into that and know it's a Metal Gear Solid ration, it's like, yeah, it's a Metal Gear Solid ration, it's so obvious. But if you don't know that, it's like, it could be anything, really could be anything. So with that in mind, let's finish up this is a round, so we're going to call it a game or a match of the Sound Effects Showdown, which lasts for 5 rounds. This is the 5th round, so let's finish it up. Turns out that this is the 5th Sound Effects Showdown that we've done all in all, so this is round 5 of match 5. Last 3 sounds this time, your last chance to rack up some points and potentially beat Shady, who I think is at the top of the list. The fact that he got no points this week is a potentially big help. Nice long one at the end there, twice more. And last time. Lewis already beating himself up in the chat saying, "Arg, what's the third one? I know it," and he just realised. So I think you do know it, my man. I'm pretty sure we have discussed this game in the past, so that's a little hint for ye. But yeah, I think you might have got yourself 2 points right there, Lewis. But we'll see exactly how well everyone's done with those sounds next week, of course. Shady's already saying that he's stumped again, so that is another potential. This is your chance, guys. You want to go for the kill on this last round and potentially win. And we'll say this, if you've won the Sound Effects Showdown before and you do win this time, I'm going to hook you up with a special t-shirt that I've got in mind for double SFX winners. And if you haven't won the Sound Effects Showdown before, we'll figure out a regular kind of package. If Shady wins, I don't know what to do. I think that's when we'll probably flick it round and let him take control of the sound effects. But we'll find out more about that next week. For now, we have another request, this time from Lewis, that he got in at the last minute just today when I told him I needed a little bit more beefing up on the playlist to make it just that little bit longer to go for 2 hours today. This is an awesome request. Such a classic. Such a classic. And I'm sure we've played a version of this on the show at some point before, but I don't think we have ever played the original actual version from the NES, the Nintendo Entertainment System. Wily's Castle 1, Dr. Wily's Castle 1, from Mega Man 2. And the fact that I haven't played this original version before really pains me. So I'm going to have to go through the old playlist and see if I did play it or not. But I think I might have played a Smash Brothers remix at some point. Yeah, I think I've hit it on the head there. Dr. Wily's Castle 1 from Mega Man 2. What a classic. Thank you. I actually really, really, really love this tune, Shirk Blubber, from a game called Level Head, which is a relatively recent release with music by Fat Bard, who we have spoken to on the show before. Shelley and I interviewed both of them about guinea pig parkour, of course, because even Douglas, my own guinea pig, made an appearance in that live interview. I decided to get him out since we were talking about guinea pig parkour. It made sense to pull out my own guinea pig. So that is an interview very worth checking out. And Fat Bard are returning onto the show next Friday for yet another live interview in which we will be speaking about Level Head and another game that's recently been released, very recently released, I believe, called Jet Lancer. And we'll be hearing from Jet Lancer later on in this playlist, and it's really, really good stuff. Absolutely loves me some Fat Bard. Their music, as we've talked about on the show before, is so absolutely varied. You never know what you can expect from Fat Bard. It seems like they can basically do it all. From like lovely jazz chord kind of stuff on acoustic guitars, I've heard, to like full pumping dance electronic tunes, to just lovely quirky little beats and melodies like what we heard from Shirk Blubber there. Really, really awesome stuff, and I can't wait to get something from Jet Lancer later on. That is a tune as well. It's going to be great to catch up with Fat Bard next week. Really, really looking forward to that one. And those guys are prolific too. They're always, always releasing stuff. So when we're talking about Level Head and Jet Lancer, that's just like two of many recent releases that have come out. So I might be able to sneak in some questions about some other things as well. There's always stuff going on in the Fat Bard camp, and that is going to be another great chat. So next up, we're going to go into another request, because we are teasing the game movie adaptations throughout this whole thing, as I like to do with the top fives. No point in doing them all at the very beginning and then having them all out of the way. No, we like to have them run through the show and create a theme. So we'll save some of those for now. We've got some very, very interesting choices. And we do have some game film adaptation stuff that's not in my top five that you guys mentioned last week. So we'll come to all of that as well. But we're continuing on with some of my playlist beefing up requests that I asked some of you guys for. And this is a great one from demo scene artist Format, who we have given a lot of love to on this show before. This is a track called Chip Music Is Dead from an album called Surrender, chosen by Ollie. And it's Format, so it's just yet more great, great, great stuff. Since this was chosen for the playlist literally like 2 or 3 hours ago, I have done no research on this. So, Ollie, give us some more information if you've got it. But I'm going to hazard a guess here, because I've only heard this track once, just purely once. I think this might be used with Amiga technology. It might be trackers, Amiga stuff going on, I think. Sounds to me like it's in Amiga territory. But Ollie, you're going to have to let me know. That's a pure speculative guess, so no one can hold it against me. Either way, Chip Music Is Dead. Album is Surrender. Really, really awesome. I'm pretty sure you can get this on Bandcamp at the moment. Goosebumps by an artist called Caspro from an album called Dark Digital. Another request from Ollie. And this is where we are going to get a little bit tenuous on today's show. Considering this is a show of VGM celebration, it's worth mentioning that today's show is relatively tenuous when it comes to the video game music. And that's part of the reason why I've opened up nice and strong with quite a lot of really good video game music right out of the gate. But now we are going to start to get a little bit more, as I say, tenuous, because that doesn't really have much to do with video games. It was just played while a crack installer was running on a game that Ollie recently stole. So there we go. That's one of the most tenuous connections ever, but he threw it at me and I loved it anyway. And who really cares? We're all just here to enjoy some great music. It's quite VGM-y anyway. It's kind of in that kind of territory and clearly influenced by that kind of world. So who cares? It's just an awesome tune. And it kind of leads us into the tenuous territory of the game movie adaptation choices that I've made today. Because although I do have some music from the games, like for example the Street Fighter movie stuff we heard earlier on, I have in some cases chosen stuff from the actual movie instead, because why not? It still ties into VGM in a way, because although in these particular cases they're actually Hollywood composers, not the original games composers, doing completely their own thing and not referencing the original music at all, there's still an element of influence from the fact that the whole game and the whole world and everything was originally a video game, so they would have to consider that to a degree and probably listen to the soundtracks and consider it in their compositions. But at the same time, it's also just kind of interesting to hear this stuff from movies just as a one-off. You know, this is very much a VGM celebration show. We don't spend the whole time listening to just random music. And this week, why not listen to some game movie adaptation soundtrack movie stuff? There's some really, really cool stuff going on. And I was glad to find it, actually, because at first I was a bit like, if I pick stuff from the movies, it's all just going to be kind of like paint-by-numbers orchestral stuff. But it really, really isn't. It turns out that there's some real bangers on some of these, even going back some distance, like to Lara Croft, Tomb Raider, the very first live-action Tomb Raider movie. Because I think, well, there's at least been two, as in, like, actors, actresses, and then they've had sequels. So I think all in all, there's like three or four live-action Tomb Raider movies. It's kind of silly because you had Angelina Jolie, and I had no idea who took the role for the reboot. No idea. I loved the game too much to watch the movie, really. I was a bit like, why? Because it'll miss all the gameplay. Why would I watch just the cutscenes, basically? But yeah, we're talking about the first Tomb Raider movie, which I was actually a big fan of when I was a kid. I was really young when it came out, and I saw it in the cinema. I must have been something like 10. Maybe even 9. I'm going to have to look at when this movie was released, because I did see it in the cinema. That'll tell me how old I was. And I actually really loved it. It's not a great film, and it's not something I would watch now, but I've put this at number 4 in my list because I loved it when I was a kid. And it meant a lot to me, actually. And it was great to see Rimmer from Red Dwarf playing her butler. I loved the role of the little mechanics guy that she had, who lived in a trailer outside her house. I loved the sequence where she was shooting up like the rock monster things. That felt like genuinely Tomb Raider-y to me. It wasn't too bad of an adaptation at all, considering that Tomb Raider, as it was at the time, was just a little bit of a skeleton of a plot as it was really anyway. It's not like it was this really super in-depth narrative with more developed characters like it became with the reboot series later down the line. It was more of a broad brushstrokes thing, and the movie took those broad brushstrokes and went in their own kind of directions in some ways, and I think in a lot of ways they got some things right, and I was pretty much happy with it. And actually Felix mentioned this one in the chat last week and reminded me of it, so thank you for that, Felix. Shout out to you for basically choosing this one. But it's ended up in my top 5 as number 4. And this is from the movie, composed by Graham Revel. It's a tune called Home Invasion. And it's that awesome scene when her home gets invaded and she's all pissing around on wires shooting everybody. But where Rimmer from Red Dwarf as the butler gets his shining moment with a shotgun, helping to protect Lara and just being a general badass around the mansion, which of course is completely different to the butler we saw in the games, who basically farted his way into the freezer. We all know that very, very well. But yeah, this really took me by surprise, this tune, because I was expecting the soundtrack to be purely orchestral dirge, frankly, but no, it wasn't. This is an absolute tune. Home Invasion from Lara Croft Tomb Raider. We'll be right back. Pikachu versus Charizard from Detective Pikachu, Pokemon Detective Pikachu. Strangely enough, my number three in my game film adaptations, with a caveat, because I hated its ending. I thought it was like two-thirds of just an incredible movie. And I think I've said this on the show before. I'm pretty sure Shelley and I, or was I doing the show with Dale back then? I mean, this is going back some time. But I'm sure I gave a live review of this, like, just after I'd watched it on the show. But yeah, two-thirds of a perfect video game movie, just got everything on the nose, and I was in love with it. I remember watching it with Shelley, and it's genuinely one of my favourite, like, video game movie, well, movie, really, memories of all time. Like, we had a beautiful, like, fully HD copy of it while it was still out at cinemas, and we felt all fucking smug about it. Sorry for the swear, mind my French. But yeah, and I remember just from its opening, like, up until like the whole like hour 10 hour 20 minutes in, I was just glued to him. Was like, this is perfect. It looks so good. The script is good. The characters are fun. The whole thing is like believable. There's a Pokemon world, and at the same time, it's going in a darker direction, a Blade Runner sci-fi inspired direction. Really awesome stuff. And then for the last third of it, just completely falls apart, just completely dies, and becomes another predictable Hollywood bore fest with just a really laughable ending action fight sequence thing, really. I remember Shelley and I were basically in hysterics at the Bill Nighy Mewtwo and thinking, this is just stupid. Like, this is not even like camp, and in a fun kind of camp way. This is like literally just terrible. Who the hell took it in that direction? And it was such a shame, for me anyway, because that's how I felt about the ending. Because Lewis has just jumped in and said it was good though, but I don't know if he's talking about the ending or the movie in general. But I remember we were just so disappointed with the ending, and the way it wrapped up after such promise and after such incredible visuals and kind of style and all of that stuff. It just became like a really paint-by-numbers thing in the last third of it for me. And as I say, totally and utterly predictable. I don't want to ruin too much of it for you if you actually want to go and check it out without seeing it. But there were some like twists and turns at the end of it, like that we both signposted from the very, very beginning of the movie. And it's kind of annoying. that it went in that direction. Sorry, just having a little look at the chat. It seems because of the lag, I confuse myself sometimes with the chat. When Lewis was said it was good, though, he was talking about his previous message, which had nothing to do with Detective Pikachu. So thanks for that, chat lag. I need to remember that there's like a minute or so between these messages coming through and what I'm saying. But we'll continue on with the game movie thing, but this one isn't in the top five. This is just one that was mentioned by you guys in the chat last week. Of course, Sonic the Hedgehog, probably the most famous game movie adaptation going around at the moment due to being released just a few months ago, really, was it? Or even weeks? It's a really, really recent thing, this. My brother Shady has got a copy of it, but I haven't actually seen it yet. So I cannot include it in the top five whatsoever. I simply can't include it. But I bet it actually probably would end up in there. Because although I started out thinking that it looked absolutely terrible, I kind of did flip around once everything started to come out with the redesign. And although I think it's a cynical marketing strategy, and I think it was planned from the beginning, to be honest with you, I think it actually looks pretty fun. If you like let your adult wits about you drop for one night and just enjoy a fun kind of silly action movie as it's supposed to be, I think it's going to be a laugh, and I'm looking forward to getting that nice HD quality file off you, Shady, and we will definitely watch that, and I'll give a live review of that as well, and probably have a ridiculously bad take on that one as well. But I am really looking forward to watching the Sonic the Hedgehog movie, despite my trepidation at first. So it's pretty obvious what I might play from this, because this really is a gorgeous choice from this movie. And quickly, this was mentioned by Lewis in the chat, and so was Detective Pikachu as well. Both of these were mentioned by Lewis, and then I've gone off and found something from them. In this case, Green Hill Zone from John Batiste, is it? I'm not wrong. Yeah, John Batiste. It's a version, a piano version of the original Green Hill Zone from Sonic the Hedgehog 1. Number one, and it's zone number one, so one of the very first pieces of music you ever hear outside of the actual title screen. I think it would basically be the second piece of music you would ever hear in the Sonic the Hedgehog series, so very, very apt that this gorgeous piano version became a part of. Well, I know it was used in trailers. I would assume it's used in the movie as well. Who cares? It's gorgeous. John Batiste's Green Hill Zone. Thank you. Suit Up from Fat Bard yet again. So that is from Jet Lancer. Like I said earlier in the show, we will be hearing some more from Fat Bard from Jet Lancer. Now, really looking forward to chatting more about that soundtrack with them next week, because there's some really interesting stuff on that soundtrack. Gets pretty goddamn heavy, actually. There's some really, really heavy tunes on there. And I don't think I've really heard Fat Bard go down that kind of road before. So I'm looking forward to chatting to them about the thick, fat guitars that they've got throughout the Jet Lancer soundtrack and finding out a little bit more about that. We've also heard a bit more about John Batiste, who it turns out plays on the Steve Colbert show, Stephen Colbert's Late Show. I was about to say, I've never watched it, and Stephen Colbert is so, like, far off my radar. Those kind of American talk show things are definitely not really on my radar. But I have seen that, like, in various clips on YouTube. And you know how those talk show hosts have bands and they have, like, a guy on keyboard or a pianist playing people in and playing them out and things like that. John Batiste plays on the Stephen Colbert live show. And this is all information from Jerry, so thanks for that. And regularly plays video game music as a part of his playing in and playing out tunes. And famously played Blanka's theme to play in Bernie Sanders, which is actually what I'd seen on YouTube like a couple of months ago or something like that, and was like, what even is this? Like, how is this happening? How is that band playing Blanka's? This, someone's overlaid this music on top and I'm not interested. I actually didn't believe it. But now Jerry's come and told us that, and it's John Batiste, who also did that in an incredible version of Green Hill Zone. That's really cool information, actually. I love that that's going on. Totally off my radar, but video game music sneaking in on a really, really, really big platform. That's fucking cool. And God damn, Lee, stop swearing. It's still because I'm still a little bit tired today. I mean, I'm pepped up, I'm ready for today's show, but I'm still a little bit recovering from the past 2 weeks of working on the Detroit episode. So sorry I'm a bit all over the place today, but hey-ho, it's a casual, fun one today. As we said earlier, tenuous. But not that much. Maybe a bit more when we get later down the line, because the way I put it in the chat was, we had that thing from a crack, which Ollie mentioned, and he said in the chat later on as well that the whole cracking thing is very close to the demo scene, and that's true with Cracktro as well, and all that kind of stuff very much fits in. So maybe it's not as tenuous as I thought. The game film adaptations, they're close enough, but then we've got a TV theme later down the line as well that's got nothing to do with anything. I'll explain why when we get to it. But with all that together, I feel like this comes to create a very tenuous, a very casual show. So who really cares that I'm a little bit more all over the place tonight? Let's just go into the next tune, which is from Final Fantasy, The Spirits Within. Really, really interesting choice. Again, this isn't a part of my top five. It's just a choice from things people were chatting about last week. I think this one was mentioned by Thor and Ollie, and I think a few people threw this one out in the chat. It was a popular choice, and I am so, so glad that you guys chose this, because I had completely forgotten that it even existed. And I actually liked this movie. I championed it. It got really, really negative reviews at the time, and everyone hated it. I saw it at the cinema when I was on holiday in South Africa, actually. I thought it was brilliant. Well, not brilliant, but I really, really liked it. I never expected it to follow any of the game threads, and I knew it would kind of be like its own thing. And I was, as long as it had some of the things that I could recognise from the Final Fantasy universe, simply like the name Cid. You know, these things that run through the Final Fantasy series, like Biggs, Wedge, Cid, various motifs that run through them. As long as some of those motifs were there, I was happy. And I felt like enough of them were there. I mean, I was a kid at the time and I haven't seen it since, but I was perfectly happy with it and completely blown away with its incredible visual effects, which at the time were just truly revolutionary. Haven't gone back since. I'd imagine it doesn't look that good today with all of the evolution we've had since, of course. But at the time, I remember it really was next level stuff, and I had to give it credit for that. And its soundtrack was by Elliot Goldenthal, And it is generally orchestral. It's generally what you might expect from an orchestral kind of soundtrack. But there's some really, really awesome stuff on there. But you can't help but think what might have happened if they'd have gone with Nobuo for the Spirits Within. I think he could have come out with some really interesting stuff, and I think it could have been a real cool challenge for him to compose for a full-length film like that. It's a kind of a shame we never got to hear that. But Elliot Goldenthal did a great job scoring it anyway, so much so that I've picked out a track, and at the last minute, Thor picked out a completely separate track, so last minute that it was too late for me to include in the playlist, and we'll come back to that next week. So we'll hear more from Final Fantasy The Spirits Within, which is a really fascinating movie. I might have to go back and rewatch it, maybe even tonight, because I've got a nice free slot after this show. This is the track that I chose out by Elliot Goldenthal from Spirits Within, and it's called Zeus Cannon. Control, with the question mark as a part of the title, from a game called The Stanley Parable, which was requested by Jerry, and I'm very irritated that I didn't know more about this game until yesterday when I was putting the playlist together. It looks like such a fascinating release and exactly the kind of thing that I could really, really get into. It is described as an interactive drama and owns the fact that it's a walking simulator. Literally describes itself as such. And it's kind of based, there's a lot of choice from what I've read. Like, you can make certain choices, including, like, there's a narrator, apparently. This is all from, I've not played this, but I really, really want to. There's a narrator who makes suggestions, apparently, and both Jerry and Lewis are going to have to confirm whether I'm right, and or rather kind of helps you through the story. And you can actually choose whether or not to take those suggestions or listen to what the narrator says or not. And depending on the choices you make throughout the game, that will actually affect your ending and affect the narrative as it unfolds. It sounds really, really interesting, especially in the kind of context that it's in. I don't want to give too much information away or too many spoilers or anything like that, because I did come across some things that spoiled it for me a little bit. I read some things about the ending that I totally didn't mean to. I absolutely wish that I didn't, but hey ho, the internet can throw these things in your face sometimes. But I would still very much like to play it. It looks so fascinating, looks so up my street. The Stanley Parable. Thank you, Jerry, for throwing it my way. Looks like Lewis is a big fan of it as well. Been talking about another track we might play from it next week. And Jerry has come in and said, choice is absolutely the theme of the game. And yes, the narrator has the things he directs you to do and adapts if you disobey him. That's really interesting. Adapts. And Lewis has come in and said, you can just ignore him and make him really annoyed. Sounds so good. I'm totally up for that kind of thing. It reminds me of Portal and the way that you could kind of, like, if Wheatley wanted you to go somewhere, you could just kind of stand there and ignore him and, like, listen to the things he said. Or there was that classic bit in Portal 2 where it is Wheatley, isn't it, where he creates that really, really easy test and he makes you do it again, like twice in a row, and it's literally just put a portal on that wall over there and you're fine. And he's like, if you stand there and ignore him, you can actually get a trophy or achievement. I think you have to stand there for like a good few minutes. He says all kinds of things. So I love that kind of thing when narrators respond to your actual actions in game. I'm going to have to get on Stanley Parable. You guys have fully sold it to me. But now we have the VGM Song Fight Battle, which usually signifies that we're right at the end of the show, but we're not quite. We've still got a few things after the VGM SongFight Battle. We've still got I've got two films to go still. I've got two game film adaptations left. We've done three. Still got little bits of music. We've got some bits to tie in to the question I'm going to pose for next week. And we have another thing from C64 Audio to close up the show before hearing that Dominic Armato demo tape. Got a lot on the plate to go. So let's jump right into the VGM SongFight Battle then and see if we can introduce it. I mean, I've not been too bad on this the past few weeks, so I'm feeling confident. The VGM SongFight Battle is where I put two tracks up against each other in a kind of SongFight scenario, and we hear both of them. And you guys choose which one you preferred or which ones you want to carry on into the next week, and you vote on a poll I put up on Twitter between the two tracks. The following week, we'll hear whichever wins up against a whole new competitor, and we'll continue the song fight on until if a track wins 3 weeks in a row, it gets taken out of contention and enters the Hall of Fame. The main thing, though, is that we tell a story, and there's a narrative that runs through each song fight. Each song fight is a chapter of this story. And if you have a look in the description post live show, you'll be able to find a link to all of those chapters on Twitter, nicely described in little quick paragraphs. So it's easy to catch up on the entire backstory of this song fight if you're new to the show. But if you are a regular listener, you're not going to want to hear the whole backstory, and we'll jump directly in to where we were, which was with M. Bison, having got the dimensional rift device, is attempting to get into Sephiroth's dimension and deliver the dimensional rift device to him. If you are a new listener, this will probably make absolutely no sense, but that's exactly what the backstory link is there for. Sephiroth is in need of the dimensional rift device, which poses a risk to him, and M. Bison, as a kind of lackey, is on his way to deliver it. Now, last week, the question was whether or not Tim from Braid, who grabbed M. Bison's ankle as he jumped through the portal, would be able to stop this, would be able to maybe slip the dimensional rift device off M. Bison's hand, or in some way win the day and get it back. But no, M. Bison just swatted him off. In fact, let's go as far as to say he crushed him. Because Tim is tiny, and we all know how big M. Bison is. And with his psycho power and everything, I don't think even time powers could get Tim out of it. And after all of this, yeah, M. Bison has crushed Tim in the palms of his hand. Tim has gone away, and he's gone straight on Sephiroth with the dimensional rift device, delivering it directly to his master. Or is M. Bison going to attempt to show off his strength and have a little fight with Sephiroth, and maybe M. Bison might be the victim? Maybe M. Bison might actually be stronger than Sephiroth. There aren't many people in this shared video game universe who could potentially beat Sephiroth, but you know what? I think M. Bison might be one of them. So to represent him, theme of M. Bison, a remix of his main theme from Street Fighter 2, from Street Fighter 5, it's a really pumping, pepped up version, which is becoming a bit of a catchphrase on this show. And then we've got to go into something that represents Sephiroth, and it's not One Winged Angel, because that has already been a part of the song fight battle, if I'm not wrong. We cannot do repeats, no sir. So first up, theme of M. Bison, and then we'll find out more about what this Sephiroth is track is when we get to it. Round one, here we go.
Round one. We'll be right back. Round 2.
Absolutely epic, amazingly epic version of Genova, which is from Final Fantasy VII, but that is the Advent Children version representing Sephiroth in the VGM SongFight battle. So, M. Bison versus Sephiroth. Will M. Bison win and then actually probably be the king villain of this whole thing, which would be a twist for me because I've planned out this whole story actually, and I've always planned for Sephiroth to be the big main bad guy, and I never planned for this twist, but I kind of like it. If M. Bison wins in the end, then anything could happen, and I kind of like that. That throws everything in the air because I think I can still retain the general ending that I'm fighting towards. And maybe just switch it over to M. Bison and we shall see. But it's up to you guys, of course. You guys can vote on the poll I'll put up on Twitter at some point in the week and we'll find out which one won next week and continue on the story. However, with a theme of M. Bison, that is the third time we've heard it. So if it wins for the third time in a row, it becomes a Hall of Famer. So either way, we won't be hearing M. Bison next week. It's just up to you guys whether or not we will hear that incredible version of Genova once again next week. We shall find out on the next show. So Genova, with it being the Advent Children version, links just about perfectly into number 2 on my favourite game movie adaptations, Final Fantasy VII Advent Children. I absolutely love it. I haven't really got anything bad to say about it. I think the only real negative that I could creep out about it is that I could have done with a little bit more Red 13 and a little bit more Kate Sith, because Kate Sith, or rather Reeve, Oh, damn, that's a big spoiler. But then again, I think Final Fantasy VII has been out for a long enough time now that you can discuss it in its entirety, really. But yeah, there's not really enough Kate Sith in that movie for me, who is an underrated character. But other than that, I mean, that scene where all of the characters come together to fight Bahamut, I think it is it Bahamut Zero? I can't remember exactly which one it was. But that scene gives me shivers every single time. Every time. And it's a beautiful movie as well. Again, it might not have aged so well, like Spirit, The Spirits Within that we heard from earlier on. Haven't watched Advent Children in a good few years now, but I remember when it came out, again, the visuals were just absolutely breathtaking. I got the same feeling as I got from that original Final Fantasy movie all over again with Advent Children. Unfortunately, though, it wasn't theatrically released. It was straight to DVD, but I don't care. I'm including it right in my list because of how goddamn good it is. I love it. I think it's a contentious thing, though. I think it is a love or hate thing, isn't it? I don't know that much about the reception to this movie in the Final Fantasy VII community. All I know is that I, as a big fan who was 7 years old when Final Fantasy VII came out and had played it from the age of seven, just loved it. It just took me right back to childhood. It really did feel like a new chapter for me, and I loved seeing these characters come back, and not just the main playable characters from the game, but like people like Reno and Rude and Rufus and people like that as well. It really did feel loving to me. I don't know how you guys feel about it. I don't know how the general Final Fantasy VII community feels about it. I really, really liked it. So there we go, Final Fantasy VII Advent Children at number 2 in my top 5. One more to go. But first up, while we're on Final Fantasy territory and we've heard a couple of things from these Final Fantasy movies, and that is, of course, Nobuo Matsu music, but pepped up. Let's hear some more Nobuo, because Lewis mentioned a few weeks ago how it's probably true that I think I probably had a run of something stupid like 10 shows where I played Nobuo on like every single show, and I can't help it. It's because I love him so much and because his music is so varied. But I shied away from playing Nobuo for a few weeks. I think I've gotten away with it now for about four weeks, sans Nobuo. So I feel like I'm allowed to bring him back this week, and that there's nothing wrong with that, especially while we've played a few things from Final Fantasy. We've heard Spirits Within, of course. Is it Spirits Within? Let's just go, because it's been so long since I've actually seen that movie, and I'm worried I'm getting its title wrong now. Hey, Elliot, where have you gone with your album? Deleted it off the playlist, have I? That's ridiculous. Oh, Final Fantasy, original motion picture. The Spirits Within, yes, I was getting it right all along. I need to stop second-guessing myself. But yeah, we heard stuff from Elliot Goldenthal on Spirits Within, and then we heard Advent Children, which is pepped-up versions of Nobuo. Let's hear Nobuo straight up. We're on the Final Fantasy VII train, so let's stay there and play a tune that I am really, really annoyed with myself for not having played on this show before. It's a real favourite of mine, and I always forget about it until I come back to the soundtrack in full, and I'm reminded again how this is really is like a top 5 Final Fantasy VII tune of mine, and I never ever include it in any playlists or anything like that. Nobuo Matsu, Final Fantasy VII, Wutai. Oh, I don't want it to end. I don't want it to end. Usually, I like to come in while it's fading out and everything, but I just don't want that one to end. And it had to fade out like that because that's the way it's cut off on the bootleg version that I heard on YouTube. I had to cut it off like that, unfortunately. But so much incredible music in the version I know of Street Fighter 2, the animated movie, my number one game film adaptation. So there's a lot to talk about here. That was Ryu's Meditation. Before we get into this movie, I'll say quickly, it's been a Street Fighter heavy show today. I didn't realize that until now. Because, I deliberately had Street Fighter bookending my top five. My number five was Street Fighter movie, which is, to be honest, a fairly bad film and a guilty pleasure. And then ending up with Street Fighter 2, the animated movie, which is not a guilty pleasure and one of the greatest films of all time, let alone the greatest game movie ever made. And then we've had M. Bison in the VGM SongFight battle as well. So very, very Street Fighter heavy show today. And apologies for that. That was an accident. But oh well, doesn't matter. Street Fighter 2, the animated movie. I'm assuming you've either seen it and love it or haven't seen it, and you'd better go see it ASAP. Try and track it down. Although it's difficult, and they make it more difficult for you by having a variety of different versions. And in my opinion, the original, because it obviously originally was in Japanese and was created in Japan with the Japanese voice cast, it's the only time where I refuse to watch the original Japanese audio with subtitles. Usually, that's what I would do across the board. Big fan of Studio Ghibli movies. Got to have the subtitles because I can't stand the English dubs. Can never stand English dubs. But in Street Fighter 2, the animated movie, it's the one case where you have to have the American dub. It's absolutely incredible. The voice acting is awesome. It's cheesy at all the right times and just like actually spot on at all of the right times. But not only does it obviously have a completely different voice cast depending on the language, but it actually has different music. And I remember I grew up with a VHS of the American version with the American music. And I might be wrong on this, but I think I'm right with all the research I've done that the American version not only injected a load of licensed tracks, but it also had a completely different original music to what the Japanese version had. And I grew up with the American version on VHS and absolutely loved it. And the music is one of its strongest points and one of the reasons why it's so good on that American version VHS that we had. And that's what Ryu's Meditation is from. But I remember I got a DVD of it much later down the line that had the Japanese version on it. And I remember thinking, always loved this movie so much in the dub. I'm gonna love it even more now I can watch it in Japanese with subtitles. That's gonna be so amazing. And I remember I was just flatly disappointed. Not only did I prefer the American voice acting, but maybe that's just after years of watching it. But I remember thinking, God damn, this music is weak. Like compared to the American version, that is just sounds really, really weak to me. So the Japanese version to me, avoid it if you can, but I think this is very much something that people have been arguing about, fans have been arguing about for years, and there's definitely no definitive opinion. But where I stand is that you want to go with the American version on this, which is definitely against the grain when it comes to watching foreign movies for me. I tend to go the subtitled route. But yeah, Street Fighter 2, the animated movie, is just an absolutely perfect adaptation. It features every single character from Street Fighter 2, including the ones that were added to later versions of the game, like DJ and T-Hawk and Fei Long. And they all play pretty awesome roles. I think like DJ, for example, has the smallest role, I think, out of a lot of them. And even he leaves a really cool impression. And they're all done to perfection. They all have their roles in the storyline to absolute perfection. It's just AAA for me. It's perfect. And I was a huge fan of Street Fighter 2, the game at the time. It was something that my brother Shady had actually bought for me as a birthday present for my Super Nintendo when I was a child. It was a very important game to me. And I remember when we got this on VHS, it was just perfect. The perfect Street Fighter movie. And I have never seen a game adaptation movie do it better. get everything on the head and actually present an independent storyline that is well worth watching, and actually went on to spawn the Street Fighter Alpha series, which was more based on the movie than it was the games that inspired it. No, Street Fighter Alpha comes from the movies and uses story elements like the evil Ken and the whole M. Bison making people evil with his psycho drive thing carried over into Street Fighter Alpha. So actually a very, very important film to the series. And as Jerry has said in the chat, so, so glad you've reminded me of this. It even has a cameo of Akuma in the background. Akuma is the only character who doesn't actually have any speaking lines or a role in the storyline, but he does sit in the background. I believe it's just before the E. Honda Dalsim fight. Which is such a great scene and a great fight between E. Honda and Dalsim. E. Honda played to perfection, hilarious character, Dalsim too. But yeah, you can see Akuma like sat in the background as a kind of vagrant. It's really, really awesome. And I remember saying to my brother, is that Akuma? And I was not being sure because the internet wasn't such a big thing at the time, but being like, that's gotta be Akuma. It looks exactly like him. So awesome. Right, I'm done gushing about Street Fighter 2, the animated movie, but I guess it is number one in my game film adaptations, so you'd expect a little bit of passion behind the damn thing. We're now going to quickly move into the question I want to pose for next week and purely indulge myself. So apologies for this one, but I think you guys should have a little bit of fun with it because we're moving towards the end of the show now. Last little duet of tunes here, then another link, then some more music and that demo tape, and then we out. But the question I want to pose to you, because of Detroit Become Human, and this is for next week, so get your answers in to me on various social media or in the chat now if you've got the time before the show ends. Because of Detroit Become Human, I've been thinking about playable artificial intelligence, playable androids, playable robots, right? And that's what I'm going to do next week. Top five playable androids, because obviously there's a lot of androids, robot characters in games, full stop, but they're not always playable. So to narrow it down, we're going to go with playable ones like Detroit Become Human. All three protagonists are androids. That's an important part of it. We're talking about characters like that. I don't want to throw too many examples out there because I don't want to step on any of you guys' toes of the choices that you might make, but quite a few come to my mind straight away, and I've got a choice, an obvious choice of mine this week, which I always like to do, a nice obvious one, and we're going to hear something from Portal 2, of course, but from the co-op mode where you play as Atlas and Peabody, the two little robotic guys who GLaDOS likes to torment. Had a great answer just come through in the chat from Jerry. That was one that was on my mind as well, but we'll come to that next week. But we're not going to hear this track from Portal 2 to represent Atlas and Peabody as my obvious artificial intelligence, playable artificial intelligence. We're going to hear another tune before we get into that, and this is pure indulgence for me, so apologies for this, but as I say, I'm pretty sure that you guys will just be able to have some fun with this. So if you follow me on Twitter, you'll be well aware of this already because I've been shouting about it loudly recently, and I think that you guys will know, maybe know what's coming since I've been retweeting it so much. I've accidentally got into a silly old 80s television show from Japan called Space Cop Gavan, although it's also known as Space Sheriff Gavan or Space Cop Gabin. It's got lots and lots of different names, and it was literally just recommended to me on YouTube because the original Japanese channel who made the show have been uploading it just to YouTube for fun. And I'm not a fan of this kind of thing at all. It's like proto-Power Rangers kind of stuff. It's called Tokusatsu, which is a genre of Japanese television, which is kind of like Power Rangers kind of thing. Kamen Rider, all that kind of thing. I've never known of any of this kind of thing because it's not my world whatsoever. But I watched this Space Cop Gavan on YouTube because it was recommended to me. I still got no idea why. And I was tired one morning and I had half an hour and I thought, screw it. And I had a riot, an absolute riot with it. It's so silly and stupid fun. And the daft things that go on, I'm laughing at it so much. And I know that sounds a bit cruel, like laughing at it, but it was like charming. It was charming and endearingly so. I wasn't laughing at it like, you're, what is this crap? I actually kind of got it. And I actually kind of put myself in the mindset of a kid in the 80s with this being on TV and this being my entertainment, being like, actually, this is fucking awesome. He's got a goddamn electronic star beast attached to his ship. And his girlfriend can turn into a budgerigar. I'm sold. That's literally all I need to know. I was perfectly happy with that. And he himself, well, he's not a robot. He is a man, but he has this kind of mechanical suit. And he is the first tokusatsu metal hero, which makes him very, very important, actually. And I've been really getting into this. And it's just been something that I've been watching in the morning to wake myself up with. And it tenuously, there's that word again, it tenuously ties into our artificial intelligence robots connection thing, since he is a metal hero. But I just thought we'd play its theme tune, because I haven't been able to get it out of my head ever since seeing it just over a week ago, I think. So this is a silly one, it's a playful one, but I actually think it's a massive tune. With your tongue firmly in your cheek. It is a massive tune. It's called Space Sheriff Gavin, but I've known the show as Space Cop Gavin by Gavin. Space Cop Gavin. I'd watch that as well. No, I know it's Space Cop Gavin, but yes, this is its theme tune from Akira Kushida, and it's such good, cheesy goodness. I love this.
Yuki, 宇宙刑事
some assembly required from Portal 2 to represent Atlas and Peabody. It has been a long time, but I think that was the loading tune, right? I played the co-op section a couple of times, but I never really had a good co-op partner to go through with it, which is a shame, because I absolutely loved it, and I always wanted to play it through a few more times. So, Shady, are you up for that? I think we should do that again at some point. We should do the old co-op. And aren't there some more co-op levels in the... what is it called? The Perpetual Testing Initiative? Is that where people can make their own tests non-stop, which is really, really good stuff? I remember I went through a huge period of playing extra tests that people had uploaded to that for a while once it became open. I should go back to that, man, because there was some really awesome stuff, actually, that totally opened the game up. And I'm sure there was some co-op extra stuff in that as well. Shady, you will know a lot more about that than I do. You'll have to let me know. But either way, I'll have to play through the co-op again one more time. It takes me right back. Some assembly required from Portal 2. Another Mike Moraski tune. Like Nobuo, I think we've played Mike on the past four or five shows now because of Half-Life Alyx coming out as well. We've had Half-Life Alyx requested a couple of times. We had Team Fortress 2 showing up in the VGM SongFight Battle. There's been a lot of Mike Moraski recently, so he might be becoming the new Nobuo Matsu on this show. Whoops. But that's never a problem with Mike's music being as quality as it is. We don't hear enough from Left 4 Dead on this show, but that's because it has a difficult soundtrack with it all being granularly kind of mixed together. I think that's the right word. Let's hope. Thankfully, we're right at the end of the show. Mike, what a legend. It takes me back to the podcast with him when I actually spoke to him, and then it was cut up into the Portal 2 Left 4 Dead. I think that's it, actually, Portal 2 and Left 4 Dead episodes. And man, he really did give the insight. And it made me think, actually, last night, listening to the Detroit Become Human episode that's just released, Philip Shepherd reminds me of Mike Moraski a lot. And he's like, even when I was doing the interview about halfway through it, I remember thinking to myself, I think Philip Shepherd might be this season's Mike Moraski, as in the one who just gives like 20-minute long responses, which is a good thing. That's actually what I'm looking for. And you can hear that playing out in the Detroit Become Human episode, these long, nebulous answers from Philip Shepherd, which is just so fascinating and so insightful. Incredible stories about Abbey Road, incredible stories about actually coming up with Kara's main theme for Detroit Become Human out in the woods, when he talks about there being a bear around every corner, and him listening to the fire and that inspiring his melody. Really awesome. So that's one last plug for the Detroit Become Human podcast, if you haven't heard it right at the end of the show, because I am particularly proud of it. It's an absolute monster of an ST2 episode, and as I stressed at the beginning of this live show, you really don't have to know anything about Detroit Become Human to come away from it satisfied, I don't think, because in general, it's just a conversation about composing for games and approaching orchestras and approaching synthesizers and various different instrumentation. So it's interesting on that level, whether or not you've played the game. It's interesting to hear about custom instruments, about working with orchestras in Abbey Road. It's just totally fascinating stuff. So we are at the end of the show, which means we have to hear the sound effects three more times. Then we've got a bit more music for you, and then this Dominic Armato demo tape, Guy Brush Threepwood's voice actor, which we have been teasing throughout the show. So we should probably just do these sound effects, just jump straight into them rather than dilly-dallying around, because we're already approaching a 2.5-hour show, which is a lot longer than I even had in mind. Sound effects showdown is three sounds from three different games. You guess what the sounds are and the games that they're from for 6 points in total. Whoever's got the most points after 5 weeks wins an actual kind of prize. We will figure it out. Here are three times on this final round. Yeah! And twice more. Last time, and I think this is a good one to end up this 5-week run of the Sound Effects Showdown. Some distinctive sounds in here. And we have had some very kind words in the chat come through about the Detroit Become Human episode. So thank you so much, Ollie, Shady and Lewis, for those kind words. It was a marathon to put that episode together. If you've heard it in its 1 hour, 57 minutes entirety, then I think you'll know how much work went into it. I worked very, very hard on it. And I was aware that the material I had from Nima and Philip deserved that kind of effort and deserved to be given the pacing and everything. And their music helped with the pacing as well. And it just came together into a really, really great end product. And I'm so glad to hear that you guys liked it after giving my all to it. Let me just say quickly as well, when I say it deserved the effort, that doesn't mean that some episodes of ST1 or 2 have been a case of, oh, this one doesn't deserve much, let's just fucking cane it out. Not at all. If you've heard any of my episodes, you know I go a bit mental on every single one of them. It just so happened that being an hour and 57 minutes long, that kind of requires three times the effort of a regular episode, since it's about three times the length. So yeah, it required big, big efforts. And I'm so glad with what we came out with. Very, very, very proud of it. And next up, that does lead me actually to talk about what I'm going to do next up, is a racing special. I'm going to take a couple of days off, of course. And then after that, I'm going to get straight to work on a racing special featuring TDK Mark Knight, Steve Rocket, and Ian Livingston, all of whom have worked on some of the biggest racing game series of all time. F1, Colin McRae, Grid, Forza, this is to name but a few. Between the three of them, they've basically worked on just about every gigantic, well-known racing simulator. And we're talking like proper racing simulators here, so maybe not things like Wipeout or Roll Cage. That's going back a few years now, isn't it? But like, maybe even Burnout, but like more kind of arcade-based racing games. No, this is more racing simulators, like proper F1 games, because we'll be talking quite in depth about the collection of engine sounds, of car noises. There are some great, great stories from TDK about that. There's some great stuff from Steve Rocket about licensed tracks, because Steve Rocket, as well as composing for games, actually helped to curate a lot of licensed soundtracks for racing games. So I took that as an opportunity to ask him, how do you feel as a composer about the use of licensed music? And obviously, I have the perspective of a lot of composers dissing licensed music and saying it's a bad thing. Steve Rocket gives kind of the other side and talks about how well a licensed soundtrack can work and the difficulty in curating that, actually. So that's interesting to hear. And finally, Ian Livingston has written some of the most amazing music for racing games. That's just so underrated. Like, we're talking full orchestras. I actually might be wrong here, but I think some of that was recorded at Abbey Road as well. But we're talking full orchestras at big top recording studios with huge electronic beats. So much effort going into it. And as I've discussed with these guys, like, so many people don't even think about the music in these games. But as we've chatted about with Ian Livingston, so much effort has gone into it. It's unbelievable stuff. So that's what I'm going to be working on next. Then a Mega Drive special. Then I think we'll probably be getting into some of the LucasArts stuff before a That Game Company special. Wowee, so much to come in ST2, and that's not even discussing some of the other episodes to come as well, like Rakuen and all sorts of little tidbits to come in ST2. So to finish up today's show, because I have been rambling on and on and on, here is the latest thing from C64 Audio and their string of orchestral render albums that they have been releasing over the past couple of weeks. We heard something from Bit 4. Bit, by the way, stands for Back in Time. But yeah, we heard something from Bit 4. We heard something from Bit 5 last week. Let me see if I can get it right. I'm sure we played the International Karate Suite and Ghosts and Goblins last week. This week from Bit 6, which again has either just been released or is about to be released very, very soon through c64audio.com. Bit 6, I think it's the last of the group. This is another Rob Hubbard classic called Spellbound, the full orchestral rendition of which is included in the 8-Bit Symphony Pro, recorded with actual players in Prague. And that is available at the moment. But this is one of Chris Abbott's amazing renders, demonstrations of what was to come before they were recorded in Prague. Well worth hearing within their own right, and it's called Spellbound. And after that, because I'm all done chatting after I introduce this track, we're going to hear that Dominic Armato demo tape, that kind of demo reel of his acting, voice acting abilities, which helped land him the role of Guybrush Threepwood for Monkey Island, requested by Thor and unearthed by Thor. Really, really nice gem, and thank you for throwing that our way. So first up though, Spellbound from Bit 6, leading directly into that Dominic Armato demo reel. Thank you again for a great night, guys. It's been really, really fun, and I'm so glad we could share this and that the majority of you guys could make it for this rejigged Saturday time slot. We will be back at the usual 7 p.m. on a Friday time next week, because I will make sure I've actually recovered and gotten some sleep. Definitely taking a few days off before getting onto the racing special. So thank you again and good night, and see you in just under a week's time. Goodbye for now.
coming to Melbourne, step right up. You can step right up.
So essentially, certain people have decided that we all fall into this dysfunctional category under the label Gen X. Yeah, we used to hate those people. Now we just make fun of them. It's more effective that way.
Hey, Wolf, wake up over there. You got a bogey coming on strong.
I can't see him.
6 o'clock high. Get out of there, man.
Oh, man, he's all over me.
Hang tight, buddy. I'm on my way.
Back when I was on the internet, we weren't surfing the web with graphical user interfaces and pretty pictures. It was all text. And we liked it that way.
Now here's how it's gonna go, see? You're gonna start looking at every dirty, filthy alleyway and godforsaken fleabag apartment in this dog-eat-dog jungle that calls itself a city, and you're not gonna stop until you find something. And you better find something. Or hope that I don't find you.
I've left a little present for you under the fridge. It's set to go off after you eat the rice pudding. Oh, you've already eaten the rice pudding? Well, then I wouldn't start reading any two-part stories.
Oh, yeah. Get a good whiff of this stuff, Joe. Nah, this ain't your run-of-the-mill litter. This is the big kahuna. Fresh, unfiltered trash.
In my dreams, I have seen Camelot, and I believe it to be my destiny, Father. I'm soon to be a man, and with all my heart, I wish to be as good and as true a man as you have always been. I love the smell of cordite in the morning. It smells like cordite. This is the way the world ends, the world ends, the world ends. This is the way the world ends, now with a bang. Talk about too much living in a city. Phew. Forget about it. My cousin Guido, he works downtown, right? One day he's taking a menthol. I'm walking here, huh? Right, so anyways, heading down Fifth Street, you know?
My name's Petey, and I'm answering the ad for the Haley Mills lookalike. Anyway, I like to play ping pong, I eat a lot of jujubes, and I really love Mel Torme.
Yeah, well, I'd get off of work in a couple hours. Man, I'm really craving potatoes hardcorely. Hey, when I finish this tranny, you wanna, like, go to the Waffle House or something?
If there's one thing I hate more than baby snatchers, it's baby snatchers with a bad attitude. I think we have us a problem here. Yep.
Well, basically what happened, Doc, is, I started aspirating on that pork sausage I was having there for lunch. So they did that Heimlich thing on me, you know, and brought me to the hospital. So here I am.
No muss, no fuss, no spills, your title gets drudgery, everything must go. How do we do it, how do we do it? Volume, volume, turn up the volume. Yeah, you got it, buddy. The large print giveth and the small print taketh away.